I need something to believe in. And tired, getting nowhere, guess it'll all work out. And I don't mind.
So, 12 months of planning, and we're ready to go. A quick removal of seaweed from the wheels before we set off. The weather's almost perfect, just a bit windy on the coast. But it was a tailwind, so not too bad. Despite all our planning, the climb out of St. Bees was much worse than anticipated, and really gave us a glimpse of what to expect over the next 6 days. We're about 4 or 5 miles into the ride now, and certainly not for the last time, but we're lost. Chris is checking his GPS, but it's still not going to help us. So we do it the old-fashioned way and ask a neighbour. It points us to the end of the street where there's an alleyway and we can pick up the railway line that we've been looking for. On the railway line, it was pretty flat and plain sailing for about the next 8 miles. We even bumped in some other coast-to-coast teams, seemingly about to take on the same journey as us. It was here where we caught our first glimpse of the Cumbrian Mountains, and at this point where our other coast-to-coast adventurers took a sharp left as though to avoid them. Probably time then to settle down and get a bit of lunch that the lads had already prepared for us. Arriving at Black Sail Hut only meant one thing to us. We knew it was the end of anything that we would have remotely thought would have been easy. From here on in, we were expecting it to be hell. And we weren't disappointed.
Absolutely crystal clear.
I find it hard to describe just how difficult some of this journey was at times. One word that kept cropping up was relentless. Because that's what it was. It just kept going on and on with no let up, no rest. We'd read about this, and we'd researched it, and we'd even watched videos, but only when we got to this wall of rock did we realise what we were really letting ourselves in for.
1,387 foot we're at. 1,387, another 500 foot yet.
When we finally reached the top, it was literally blowing a gale. But at least the hard work was over. A nice ride down the other side of the mountain. Or so we thought.
Two black lines streaming out like a guidance line. One foot on the road now where the sideboards are driving. With the WD.
Not 100 yards in, and we're off. The stream to cross, and then immediately over the stream, it was just too steep.
With the briefcase empty and the holes in my shoes, I try to stay friendly for the sugary abuse. So tell my secretary now to hold all of my calls. I believe I can hear through these walls.
Terrain becomes rideable, we have our first crash, and unfortunately it's me. Nothing damaged, just me pride, but now the first one's behind us, our kid can open up the floodgates.
Well, I've been dreaming of jet stream.
It's a narrow escape, but we all know we can do better than that.
7,000 foot wanderlust. And we're skyline number 9 to dolphin my mind. Oh, can you hear me screaming out now through the telephone lines? Oh, please save me from myself. I can't be.
Just about escaped death and injury when we had our first encounter with one of Britain's most deadliest creatures. Cows. Now, I was initially mocked by the side of this mountain for having a slight fear of cows, but in fact, after a bit of research, I found that 481 people have been killed or injured by cows in the past 8 years alone. A statistic that I, for one, am keen to avoid.
Oh dear.
We're just arriving now at one of our set rendezvous points. We're just short of 2 hours late, and with no contact with the backup team, they had no idea where we were. And in fact had given us another 15 minutes before they were going to set off without us. And it was this incident that set our new rule. No one was to leave a rendezvous point without actually making contact or meeting. And it's a rule that played a vital role a couple of days later. The scenery in this part of the Lake District is absolutely breathtaking. With Scarfell Pike, England's highest mountain, immediately behind us, and Wast Water just to our right, it's easy to become distracted. And whilst taking it all in, we just realise that we've taken a wrong turn. We should actually be over where those walkers are on the right hand side of the screen. It doesn't take too long though to turn round and get back on track. Now as we approach this water crossing, you'll be able to see from my body language that I don't want to ride across here. In fact, I lift my leg off the bike because I want to walk. But you can see our kid goading me, Chris giving me peer pressure from behind the camera, and I find myself turning the bike around to make an unwilling attempt. As I line the bike up under duress, the goading continues. End of sleep, time I go. I'm gonna take my shoes up the door. I'm gonna go with dreams like rivers flow. Oh, whoa. When the alarm goes off, I just won't know. Don't you come with me, won't you? Bastards. Oh, they're gone in the morning. I wanna know why they're gone. Still, what goes around comes around. They're gone in the morning. I wanna know why they're gone in the morning. I'm gonna master all kinds of kung fu. I'm gonna live inside a tiny zoo. I'm gonna grow myself a giant afro. Incredible. Whoa, when the alarm goes off, I just won't know. Won't you come with me? Won't you? Before they're gone in the morning, I wanna know why they're gone in the morning. I feel alone. Day 2 starts pretty much the same way that day 1 left off. Really steep climb out of the Eskdale Valley. And then once on the top, again we found ourselves with the bikes on our shoulders trying to traverse fallen trees and deep bogs. The scenery is amazing, but all this carrying bikes on our shoulders and walking is really making for slow progress. The one upside is that as we approach Walna Scar Road, at least it's a track that we've all ridden before and a place that we're familiar with. That said, it is the highest summit of the entire ride, at nearly 2,000 feet from sea level. It's about 4 miles from the top of Walna Scar summit to Coniston town centre, and on a good day this would take us about 15 minutes to do. But with another 4.5 days of riding ahead of us, we decided to take it very easy on the way down. We're on board with Chris here, and as you can see, the camera's becoming really shaky and unstable, and on top of that, he can't keep up with me. What Chris doesn't realise is that he's locked his front suspension for the climb up, and he's forgot to unlock it for the ride down. And unfortunately for Chris, he isn't going to realise this until he hits some nice smooth tarmac right down in Coniston town centre. We're about 2 miles outside Coniston here, and we're settling down for arguably what was one of the best roadside meals the lads had cooked for us on the entire journey. We're feeling pretty good, the riding's getting better, and the weather's holding up. All in all, it's turning out to be quite enjoyable. Heading away from Coniston now, and we're back in unfamiliar territory. Contours are heading in the right direction, which is downwards, so it's time to really just sit back and enjoy it. We're still steep and rocky in places, so still need to have your whips about you.
Just that rock. and just went rolled straight over that rock.
They didn't. Well, I learned to regret it, or should I forget it? Whatever this is, it feels electric. You shot me a sweet look, gave me a yearbook, told me to sign, it was a signal. But I couldn't find the words, I just couldn't find the nerve. As you for you. An army of managers and lots of pretty boys lining up to meet with you. Oh, I'm pretty sure that it was you that I bumped into just the other day at the record store. But I still don't have a clue, I just couldn't talk to you as you like some neon silhouette. I'm slowly losing oxygen and my hands are soaking wet. All the cameras and reporters piling up on one another just to get a look at you. Hey, I want an interview. Then I make my move, push them out of my way. But I still just don't know what to say. Here's my bright idea.
Strong winds gusting at times up to around 80 miles per hour and indeed some torrential rain. Now, in fact, the arrival of this storm couldn't be at a worse time. Somewhere between midnight on Monday morning into the Monday morning rush hour. So we're looking at some fairly chaotic conditions, and obviously people are being asked to take a lot of care. Carrying a fully charged mobile and some waterproof clothes is a good start, and of course avoiding routes where you might find trees that have come down or flooded roads.
Needless to say, day three didn't start off great. The fantastic end to yesterday's ride had quickly been forgotten within the first 5 minutes. We'd woken up to a severe weather warning. We'd had a quick discussion in the morning about changing the route, but we all agreed, and some might say foolishly, to stick to the original plan and head over Garburn Pass. Things didn't seem too bad at the bottom, to be fair. I mean, it was wet and it was miserable, but once your legs got warmed up, it was okay. Other than it raining, obviously prolonged for about 12 hours now, and the river's been a little bit swollen, there was nothing really, no real signs of anything dangerous that lay ahead. The conditions steadily get worse throughout the course of the day. We're still only maybe an hour or two into it, but as you can see, the track's starting to turn into a bit of a riverbed. On top of this, some of our equipment's starting to fail, like the waterproof camera on the top of our kid's head. The camera will only roll now for about 30 seconds before it cuts out, and that's really why there's not a great deal of footage of the worst stuff to come. As we reach the summit, you can see how deep the water's getting on the track now, but it's starting to flow in the opposite direction because obviously we're heading down the other side of the hill. We stopped to lift the bike over some fast flowing water, and this is the first of many, but each increasingly getting bigger, where we were eventually crossing 6 foot wide bodies of fast flowing water, sometimes wading through waist deep. It was stupid looking back really, but at the time there was no mobile phone signal and no CB reception, so we had no option but to carry on. Still, it couldn't get any worse, or so we thought. Disaster couldn't have struck at a worse point. We were at our most remote section throughout the whole 6 days, when Chris's rear derailleur snapped off, leaving him without gears. All in all, we maybe lost an hour's time mucking around trying to get the bike mobile again, and eventually it just led to us having to limp the thing back down the mountain without any power at all, me pushing Chris along at times. No CB reception, no mobile phones, horrendous weather conditions, and completely on our own.
I never knew that everything was falling through, that everyone I knew was waiting on a cue to turn and run when all I needed was the truth. But that's how it's gotta be. It's coming down. And more than apathy, I'd rather run the other way than stay and see. What's up? 8 seconds left in overtime. She's on your mind, she's on your mind. Everyone knows she's on your mind.
See, there's still reminiscence of yesterday's flooding to overcome. We take a little detour on this side of the wall just to avoid a bull that's staring at us in the field on the left hand side. The day's only just begun and it's looking like another day of hiking and carrying bikes on shoulders across fields that are unrideable. Once again, the scenery is amazing, but you struggle to enjoy it when you're in pain and when you're a bit despondent from the lack of progress that you're making throughout the days. Just as I'm talking to myself about how steep the drop is, I trip on my shoelace and nearly end up at the bottom of the valley.
There you go. The sort of thing that's going to get me killed, isn't it?
And with near perfect timing, the support crew starts to play a song across the radio that sums up the exact moment.
I'm waiting for you, for I'm broken down, coming down this time for my heart lies far away when it took you down. Let them over to your house where I'm broken down by the people. If they let you breathe, don't give a damn if you still can't see my heart beat for you. I've become all I lost, all I hoped for, but I must carry on, always one, never broken. Where I saw you try, don't give a damn for your reasons why. church bells cry. I'll lead them over to your eyes. Oh, I am one. I am one. Break story out, peace and love in a future bright. Sacrifice came around, never broke. Don't give a damn if you still can't see. Traveling a street that I did not know. Wheels like tongue to the winter low. Down in the valley where the church bells cry, I'll lead them over to your eyes.
The afternoon's riding takes a turn for the better, and we start to make some progress.
This one. Cheers, pal.
With some kind guidance from the local friendly farmer, we make our way through what seems like the UK's largest collection in stinging nettles. We're treated to a cracking orange sky just before we drop into Richmond. It's a nice smooth descent down the hill, where we're about 4 miles then from our first of our two camping barns. As we drop into Richmond, it's a nice easy 4 miles, all tarmac, to the camping barn in Brompton.
Here.
There hasn't been enough mentioned about the support team that were following us. Brownie and Holmesy were carrying all our equipment and cooking our meals during the course of the day. Without those guys, this wouldn't have been possible for us really. Leaving out that they greeted us with just soup and bread, at the end of the worst day of our lives, they were absolutely unfallible. Come the end of day 4, unfortunately Holmesy had to rush home on an emergency. However, he was replaced with Brownie's wife Jill, so the order of the day for day 5 was organisation. During the stay overnight, we'd done all our usual checks on the bikes and found that our kid's rear wheel bearing was starting to seize. So during the course of the night, we managed to ship up another spare bike, kindly donated to us by Mr. Buckley. The morning of the fifth day brings a lot of tarmac riding, which is good in one respect because we get a lot of miles under our belt early. And by the time we hit the trails, the sun's really beating down on us, and there's a real good feeling about the day. but mix that with a sense of sadness as well, because it's almost coming to an end. But it's not over yet. We've got plenty of miles to rack up and plenty more smiles to be had. whilst Holmesley was sadly missed, Jill brought a breath of fresh air into the camp. For example, after cycling the hard morning, when we pulled into the car park for lunch, there was actually chairs laid out for us to sit down on, and washing hung up in the sunshine. But lunch was soon over, and we were back to hiking, bikes on the shoulders, trudging through overgrown paths that were barely visible. It doesn't quite show it on camera, but these ferns are absolutely infested with bluebottles. I mean, the only time I've seen more flies is when Chris left his underwear in the Land Rover at the end of day two. It was at about this time every day where I seemed to get my second wind. So as we set off, I start to set the pace. And I'm shortly after told on the radio to slow it down. And it's just at the top of that hill that we get our first glimpse of the North Sea. Day 5's accommodation was Farndale Camping Barn. And when I say camping barn, it was quite literally a barn with bunk beds in it. We were due to share the barn with a couple of walkers, but when they turned up and saw the place, they turned their nose up at it and walked down to the local village called Church Houses and booked a B&B. Day 6 was an early start, and anyone that has this romantic idea about living on a farm and being woken up by cock-a-doodle-doo at 7:30, well, I'm afraid you're very sadly misguided. About 2:45 these mutant cockerels started giving off cock-a-doodle bwark. Although that said, I don't think it's put Brownie off, because he was talking to the farmer about his ideal life for about 4 hours the previous evening. We couldn't get rid of the guy. So day 6 starts with quite a steep climb out of the village Church Houses. But once we're at the top of the valley, the sun's shining, it's an absolute glorious day, and it's the home stretch. With it being the final stretch, we all seem to have woken up with fresh legs this morning. And we're soon racking up the miles. Another thing spurring us on is every now and again we'll just catch a glimpse of the coast. A visual reminder of actually how far we've got to go. But it's obviously not all downhill, and there's still a bit of work to do. The Land Rover coming into its own on day 6. Just unfortunate that Holmes is not here to be in it. We'd saved the steepest tarmac section for just before lunch on the final day. And as we pull in and settle down for some lunch, we notice that there's a car broken down at the end of the lay-by. It's a district nurse on call. And being as charitable as we are, Brownie offers his services and gets her on her way again. Just a last final push now to the finish line. The last 5.5 days have been the most epic experience. When we dreamt this up, we started out with 10 riders, and we slowly whittled down to 3. The 7 riders that dropped out will never know what a truly epic adventure they've just missed out on. It's been without doubt the best 6 days of my life. And let's not forget, this was all for the staff of the Royal Belfast Hospital for Sick Children.